Jurgen Pohlman was the talk of the tennis world during the first week at Forest Hills. Most considered it the worst display of his career. Some of the underlying reasons were justified. Pohlman delayed the match several times with leg cramps, while play is supposed to be continuous. On this occasion, he was attended by a physician, which should spell automatic default, but didn't. Nastasi complained bitterly, and the already outraged crowd jumped all over him.
Everybody think I'm going there and, you know, to upset the other guy playing, but the most upset is me, because I have to play the game, I have to concentrate, I have to talk with the crowd, I have to do all these things, but I don't do it just to disturb the other guy. First of all, I am the one to be disturbed.
Nastasi has always claimed that his sometimes outlandish behavior is not pre-planned, as it does cause him to lose more matches than it does his opponents. And surely behavior such as that displayed in this match would not have been preconceived. At the end of the match, Nastasi spat across the net at Pohlman, whom he felt had been playing to the crowd by overdoing his cramps. They didn't shake hands, nor did the umpire, who had never gotten control of the match, shake hands with Nastasi. Veterans Marty Reason and Tom Ocker won the doubles final over relatively unknown Cliff Letcher and Paul Kronk, two unseeded young Aussies. Cliff Letcher played on the American Express Card Challenger circuit this summer, a series of tournaments designed specifically to provide continuous tournament competition for emerging tennis stars. Cliff nearly qualified for this rain-delayed final. For the second year in a row, the United States Tennis Association staged a battle between the Eastern and Western Division champions of the Challenger circuit on center court. In this, the third consecutive tiebreaker, Dick Bornstedt is trying to avenge last year's loss to the East by defeating this year's Eastern champion, Butch Seawagon, a very tough clay court player. Bornstedt wins it, and both players are joined at the presentation by Morris Siegel, the president of the American Express Card Division. Even though scheduled a winner-take-all, American Express Card gave Butch Seawagon $1,000 for his great effort, as well as Dick Bornstedt, his $5,000 winner's purse. Women's tennis today is totally dominated by two players, not due to the lack of depth in the women's ranks, but to the outstanding abilities of Yvonne Goolagong and Chris Evert. Yvonne is perhaps the most fluid, poetic woman ever to grace a tennis court, and Chris is a study in mental and physical domination. Diane Fromholtz lost in the semifinals to Yvonne Goolagong, but on this point exploits a weakness sometimes evident in Goolagong's game. She sometimes becomes a bit lackadaisical, like here, where she only partially gets to the net. Mimi Jasovic lost to Chris Evert, but demonstrates here what you must do against a great player. If you receive a weak shot, you must commit yourself. And of course, you must hit your shot. But in general, Chris Evert will dominate, especially on clay, where she reigns alone. Because she hits deeply and accurately, rarely misses, and is always on top mentally. She can hit from the baseline forever, and eventually her opponent will miss a shot, or Chris will hit an out-and-out winner. It's the fourth consecutive United States Open final for Goolagong, but defending champion Chris Evert hasn't lost on clay in over 3 years. The semifinal was her 100th straight victory on clay. At 3-all in the first set, it seemed even. There's Yvonne getting caught at half court, a deadly proposition against Evert. Yvonne follows a weak serve in and is caught at half court again. Evert will win this game at love and not lose another game. What can you do when even the breaks go against you? The final set was a disaster for Yvonne. She never got her game going, and Chris was devastating, as she was throughout the entire tournament. Two years in a row now, and the amazing Chris Evert lost but 12 games in this year's United States Open. Chris Evert is in a class by herself on clay. But Yvonne Goolagong has had a great year, and she'll be back because right now she and Chris own women's tennis. Avis Rent-A-Car, this year's sponsor of the men's singles competition. And singles competition always means Jimmy Connors. He went into the semifinal round against Guillermo Vilas without having lost a set. He was on a rampage this year at Forest Hills, and this is one of the few high points of the day for Vilas. Connors lost only 7 games in this semifinal, in which he charged, volleyed, caught the lines, and just plain blasted his ground strokes too hard for one of the top players in the world to handle. Vilas would comment later, "What can you do when the ball is being hit at you 200 miles per hour by someone who never makes a mistake or misses a line?" The answer, of course, is nothing. At the press conference following the match, the number one seed levels some legitimate complaints at reporters who harp on his not having won a major title last year.
"You bring up 75 so much, why don't you bring up 74 a little bit? You know, Christ, you know, there's only one guy better than me in 74, and he made me. Don't just cut one guy down because he hasn't won a big title or he hasn't done this or he hasn't done that. You know, I don't agree with that. You know, I agree that, you know, I didn't win a Wimbledon, I didn't win a Forest Hills, I didn't win an Australian, but who would want to have my record in 75? Everybody that plays a game would like to have lost in the finals of all three. So if you're going to live on that, you know, live on me being the greatest player of all time in 74 by winning 99 out of 103 matches, or else drop it."
Bjorn Borg lived up to his nickname, the Iceman, on his way to the men's finals. Down 2-5 in set 3 against Jaime Fio, the imperturbable Swede fought back to a third set tiebreaker and then won this second round match. In the fourth round, he was down 2-0, but came back to beat Brian Gottfried. In the quarters, defending champion Manuel Orantes nearly staged another miraculous comeback, reminiscent of last year's semifinal victory over Vilas. Down 4-0 in the fourth, he came back to win the set. But Borg didn't panic, played his game, and won in the fifth. And that was it for last year's popular champion. In the semifinals, though, Ely Nastasi met a Bjorn Borg who had finally reached his peak form in this tournament, just as he had done earlier in the year while defeating Nastasi in the Wimbledon final. Ely never got into one of his brilliant streaks, and Borg kept pressure on him throughout the entire match. He was hitting out, controlling the flow of the match, and demoralizing Nastasi, who could never get on track. Borg took the first set easily. Second set, Borg ahead 3-1 and 30-40. Out, and Nastasi saves the game, but he can't break back. Serving now at set point. Borg isn't missing. 6-3 in the second. 2-2 in the third. Borg serving to go ahead 3-2. In, and the irascible Nastasi is beside himself. Yeah. the Stasi serving now with double match point against him. So the 20-year-old Swede will face Jimmy Connors tomorrow in the finals. In the locker room following the match, he says the United States Open is special.
I think it's because this is the only one I have left of the big ones. I won French and Wimbledon and Rome and the Davis Cup. And now it's the only one left, so I want to win one really badly, this one.
Early Sunday morning and the hope for perfect weather is here. The empty stadium is a silent prelude to the footsteps, the hits, the groans, and the emotion that will all be a part of this United States Open final at Forest Hills. Some without tickets are still hoping. Those with tickets are anxious and excited. Bjorn Borg warms up quietly at the clubhouse. Long before the tennis starts, the crowds begin to meander towards the stadium. As the event draws near, the portals become active. And inside, this is America's bicentennial United States Open. Over 16,000 people and millions more on television will watch. Connors jumps into the early lead, serving now for the first set. The crowd senses a great one today, and they're as keyed as the players. And they're right. In the second set, Borg gets on top and stays there. It's been a question of whether Connors can hit his approach shots well enough to nullify Borg's deadly passing game from the baseline. Connors usually loves topspin hitters like Borg because he receives the ball high and can power it back the way only he can. But Borg may be the fastest retriever in tennis, and it's hard to hit anything where he can't get to it. Third set, Connors ahead 6-5. Borg needs this game to force the 12-point tiebreaker. He's not hanging back, and it pays off. Now begins the most thrilling tiebreaker in the 6-year history of the system at the United States Open. In the 12-point tiebreaker, it's the first to reach 7 points, but you must win by 2. A hushed audience now as Connors prepares to serve at 4-all in the tiebreaker. Right on the line, and neither player is playing conservatively. Borg will take the next point and has Connors down 2 set points at 6-4 in this all-important third set. Still set point Borg. Six all, and they change sides. An ace. Set point, Connor. Short breather now for the players, as well as the crowd, as they change sides. What a tremendous ovation for both players. And these fans know they're seeing the two best at their best. Set point, Connors, at 10-9. That's the set, and Bjorn Borg is down 2-1. And Jimmy Connors? He's in a trance. His momentum carries over into set four, and he needs this game for his first national title since 1974. It's deuce. Point, Connors. Thank you. Iceman survives again. Out, and you can't do this very long against Jimmy Connors. Match point number three. So Jimmy Connors, who said he paid for his overconfidence after 74 in 75, is back again in 76 and plans to stay. Presenting the checks, along with Stan Molesk, president of the USTA, is the chairman and chief executive of Avis, Winston Bud Morrow.
Bjorn, we have a special affinity for those who are number two, and I guess that's it tonight. Congratulations. Well, Jimmy, you're really number one, and now you're $30,000 richer. Congratulations. With Bjorn being only 20, I'm only 24, so if he's going to come back, I'm going to come back.
So, it's a late good night from the finals of the 1976 United States Open, brought to you by American Express Card and Avis.